Respected chairpersons, ladies and gentlemen, I'll be speaking to you about the pathophysiology of heart failure, which all of us have been studying right from student days. A few days ago, at the height of summer, suddenly we had a small little emergency at home. All the pipes ran dry, there was no water. And I was also involved, and I was also involved in the panic, and I called the plumber. And I thought, like a typical cardiologist, there must be some block somewhere. Maybe it's a block, maybe it's a dissection or plaque disruption. But when he looked at my pump, he said, it's your pump which requires replacement. It's got a little gone. I said, but it's only 5 years old. How did you get into that idea? He just laughed at me. And he says, this is only a pump. You have to go for a replacement. So suddenly, I remembered another pump which all we have, not in our garages, but in our own chest. One which doesn't require any maintenance, any replacement, and it's supposed to work from womb to tomb. Maybe occasional bit of replacement, a tiny tot of red wine, maybe. Otherwise, it'll be good. But it's dynamic. It is supposed to be working at rest as well as with exercise. The Starling's law, which we learned, told us that the initial fiber length, diastolic fiber length, will dictate the cardiac output. The more the diastolic, the stretch, the further improvement on the cardiac output. This works very fine, even in during exercise, as the topmost graph shows, that even normal heart, when it, supposing you are faced with a extra exercise or increase in heart rate, extra load, definitely it will work better. But something happens when the pump starts deteriorating. When there's heart failure, this starts working at a lower curve and it deteriorates. We all are aware of the various pathological conditions where a normal functioning myocardium is reduced to a thin dilated balloon and with hardly any pumping. What happens? What has happened to all the nature's reparative mechanisms? We know that in spite of all available treatment, including the best of pacings and resynchronization therapies, still we have the problem of a large dilated heart which cannot be salvaged. What are the causes of heart failure? This of course includes a whole list of cardiac diseases. It could be a congenital cardiac disease or acquired, valvular, ischemic, hypertensive, and various cardiomyopathies. At one time there were only 3 cardiomyopathies: dilated, hypertrophic, and restrictive. Now 2 more have been added, the right ventricular cardiomyopathy, arrhythmogenic, as well as the non-impaction of LV. Whatever be the cause, ultimately when the heart starts deteriorating, it's a downhill course. And the pathophysiology and prognosis are very, very bad, as you all know. Yesterday's topics told us that there is 50% of mortality at the 5 years. Now there are a lot of changing views about heart failure. Is it a clinical syndrome, is it a circulatory disorder, or is it just pure altered architecture of the failing heart? Or is it basically a fluid balance problem? Maybe some biochemical abnormalities have taken place: energy starvation of the heart, depressed contractility, neurohumoral stimulation. Maybe it's a maladaptive hypertrophy, genomics, epigenetics, all brand new terminology finding their way into the textbooks. Today, instead of going through the normal pathway, we would like to speak a few words about these topics which have come up recently. One is, we should focus on the loss of energy which drives the pump, disturbed excitation-contraction coupling that has happened, altered preload and afterload conditions, the death of the myocardial muscle, and of course, we have to pay an attention to the matrix, the interstitium, cardiac interstitium, about which we hardly spoke about earlier. Coming to the energy starvation, we all know that the tired hearts do not produce the same amount of contraction, the cardiac output falls, the blood pressure starts falling, as you all know. Now, recently only, they could actually record that by nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy and other analytical methods, that myocardial ATP and phosphocreatine levels fall in a failing heart. And the ATP levels will now start progressively falling every day, and that's why it goes on a spiral. This is a path of replenishment of the ATP. Heart muscle requires a lot of energy. And you'll be surprised to know that there's no storehouse of energy in the heart. The amount of energy that is left is hardly 10 millimoles, enough to last a few beats if you stop the circulation. But 10,000 times in a day, it has to be replenished. It's a perfect recycling example where by glycolytic pathway, Krebs cycle, or oxidative phosphorylation, the energy cycles keep on replenishing and thus give the cardiac muscle the energy required. Well, now, where is the cardiac muscle? Where does it require? Ultimately, it goes to the cardiac myofibrils, where we all know by histology, the actin and myosin, they glide over each other to form the contraction as well as relaxation technique. The key to the excitation-contraction coupling is the calcium. The calcium has to enter the cell through the signal-activated channels and also has to release from the endoplasmic reticulum, and ultimately the calcium will give the energy to the contraction-excitation coupling, by which all of us are know, and most probably earlier all the glycosides were working on this principle. Now, what goes wrong in a failing heart? There's a prolongation of the action potential, there's a slowing down of the systolic shortening, and there's a reduced force of contraction as well as shortening. So the changes in calcium handling in the cardiac myocyte is the key. There's also an alteration of sarcolemmal protein, which are additional contributors to congestive heart failure. Now we understand that even before the systolic failure comes, there is an element of hypertrophy followed by diastolic failure, and so you have heart failure now with normal maintained ejection fraction. What is this ventricular hypertrophy? Is it good or is it bad? It has been seen that universal response to myocardial insufficiency or injury is hypertrophy. There is concentric hypertrophy or eccentric hypertrophy. It could be physiological or adaptive. Like in the case of athlete's heart, we find people, conditioned athletes do have a thick muscle, but it's perfectly functioning. Pregnancy also gives rise to some amount of hypertrophy, but later on, if you stop the stress, it'll become all right. But pathological stress is maladaptive. It perpetuates, it carries on and on. Now, why does hypertrophy occur? Laplace's equation says that the amount of wall stress that is felt by a tube is directly proportional to the cavity pressure and also the radius, and inversely proportional to the wall thickness. To maintain the wall stress same, there is a physiological stimulus to increase the thickness of the chamber. So in here, we have got a ventricular hypertrophy, which keeps the stress constant. But something goes wrong, it doesn't make matters all right. Maybe sometimes it even worsens it. So the questions were being asked. Is hypertrophy really essential to maintain systolic function when faced with moderately elevated afterloads? So we have this term called maladaptive hypertrophy, where in 1950, Meyerson has said overload-induced hypertrophy can be a double-edged weapon, both beneficial as well as deleterious. And the concept of ventricular remodeling was first coined in 1985 by Braunwald et al. They found there are extrinsic factors as well as intracellular signal pathways which start this process of hypertrophy. Sometimes there is a stretch on the cellular membrane which itself starts the cell to start hypertrophy. I'll come to it later. Again, the understanding of maladaptive hypertrophy coincided with the success of ACE inhibitors in the various trials, which will be spoken to later. Now I come to the neurohumoral factors. As you all know, the sympathetic and renin-angiotensin pathways work overtime in congestive cardiac failure and lead to, they try to correct the problem by conserving sodium and water and also causing vasoconstriction. Though they are initially, they support the circulation, but slowly adversely affects the heart function in the long term. The age of beta blockers and ACE inhibitors and heart failure had arrived by the late 80s. When I was a student, even in the medicine in the 1970s, if you had mentioned beta blockers as a form of heart failure, you would have possibly failed. But now, if you don't mention beta blockers and angiotensin converting enzyme blockers, most probably you will never pass. What is renin angiotensin aldosterone system, which is all of you are aware? Angiotensin is a protein produced in the liver, and angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2 are through the action of the angiotensin converting enzyme. And angiotensin 2 is one of the most powerful vasoconstrictors known. It increases sympathetic activity. It also conserves sodium and also causes severe vasoconstriction and increases ADH secretion. So thus increasing the blood supply to the juxtaglomerular apparatus. But something goes wrong, and this perpetually increasing volume overload ultimately harms the body. So when the medicines, sympathetic various types of amines which we are using, inotropes, they fail to produce the desired effect, then we started looking at the genes. One of the first studies to identify the mutation in the genes was possible in hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, where NYH7 encoding was possible. Later on, they realized only a big family of gene mutations and many such possible. Now, even in dilated cardiomyopathy also has become a popular target of research. Multiple gene abnormalities have been identified. Two major subgroups of protein have been identified. In the cytoskeletal, the dystrophin and desmin are the targets, and the sarcomeric proteins, beta myosin, heavy chain, etc. At the same time, something else is also happening in the myocardium, that is cell death. We all know cells die by aging or by a pathological process. Apoptosis is a regulated cell suicide. Automatically, after it serves its function, it's supposed to die. It's the energy requiring step. Necrosis is unplanned cell death due to some noxious stimulus. Autophagy is a normal process of catabolism. It's a perfect cycle, recycling. The cellular protein is ingested by the cell itself. So all these are going on at the same time in the cell. And it's very interesting that the cytogenetics have identified certain proteases enzymes called caspases, which are called death proteins. They are triggered by some noxious stimuli and they start eating away the myocardial fibrils, and most probably that explains the way dilated cardiomyopathies that we all see nowadays. See, is there some way to stop? Next, the role of interstitium. We all take for granted when the myocardium thickness is seen in the echocardiogram that everything is fine. But it may not be all myocardium. It could be a collagen. With prolonged cardiovascular stress, a cascade of compensatory structural events occur, and this continuous process is called remodeling. And significant alteration in the extracellular matrix also occur, resulting in the changes in the cardiac geometry. Then a few proteins are procollagen, collagen, integrin, fibronectin, laminin. Now, certain enzymes are called matrix metalloproteases. They are a family of zinc-dependent proteases that play a role in ventricular remodeling. They possess a large portfolio of biological functions and can be modified by various new hormones, steroids and cytokines. This will be the target for pharmacotherapy. Inside the cardiac myocyte, a total explosion of new genetics, genetic material have been identified, which has been responsible for alteration in the myocardial pathway. I'm glad I'm not a DM student nowadays. It will be extremely difficult for a person to remember all the various details. What is the future? The future directions are that there is research going on to identify novel targets to modify those intracellular molecular signaling pathway. It is said that all of us, adult myocytes, in between adult myocytes, there are certain fetal myocytes, and when there is a stress, the fetal myocytes take over and they start replicating as if it is a infantile cell, and then the hypertrophy starts very, very early. Maybe circulatory assist devices may help in removing the hemodynamic stress, the original triggering factor, and thus reverse the whole process. What we have seen in the previous lecture, the surgery does arrest the further progression of ventricular remodeling. So, ladies and gentlemen, with these few words of introduction into the fantastic world of cytogenetics, I say thank you so much.